casual banter.
I'm clicking the go live button right now.
Give people a few minutes.
Yeah, we'll just do some casual banter real quick.
Speaking of casual banter, hello everybody. We are now live, and you're going to be hanging out with us. We're going to wait for just a little bit to allow people to kind of enter. It looks like we currently have 9 of you hanging out with us. Jeff from Pinnacle Press, shout out to you. I know I just left your office, and I know you're watching, so thank you for being here. But yeah, we're just going to give it a little bit here, and we'll get started here in a minute or two. So how was your week, RJ? You have a good week?
Good, besides the doom and gloom weather.
Man, it's Ohio.
It makes me sleepy.
It was super hard to wake up in the morning. This morning, I was like 10 minutes late to the Belden Village Professionals meeting.
Oh, yeah. It is Thursday. I've been messed up since Thanksgiving in terms of days of the week and when the weekend's actually here.
Right. What about you, James?
It has been an eventful week, to say the least. But we are all here, and hopefully we have a good time.
Cool. Well, it looks like there are about 8 of us hanging out. I'm going to just do a quick cross-check of our stream.
Do we want to wait till... we can hold off till like 11:05.
Yeah, I'm going in and looking at the stream right now.
Perfect.
Hopefully everyone's having a good Thursday so far.
What?
Still early, but
talk to us in the comments. Oh, Jeff says, "What's up, everybody? Good morning."
Good morning. If any feedback is great too, seeing as this is our first live stream that we're doing through our YouTube. If you guys can hear us all right, or you can't see something, the more feedback we get, the better we can make these going forward.
Yep, and if there's any questions at any point, feel free to stop us. We'll be happy to answer any questions throughout, but we do have time at the end set aside for the Q&A. So,
Tracy Don Brewer also says hello, everybody.
Hello, Tracy.
Hi, Tracy.
Should have quite a few familiar names and faces joining us.
Oh, yeah.
What does it look like on YouTube? Yeah, I've never streamed on YouTube before, so is it like the email that they sign into YouTube with, or do they have to enter their own name?
Or is it... it's just a stream link on our channel right now.
But when they're chatting, it just shows up their
name.
Oh, okay. Or so
is it like, yeah. Oh, our audio sounds super crispy coming through that stream right now. I love cool. that for us.
Cool beans. Cool beans.
All right. It looks like more people are kind of flooding in. So let's go ahead and get this party started. And by get this party started, I mean, we're going to get me out of the way and get everybody to the programming they actually came for, which is not me rambling about random things. So I am Jan Almasy, CEO and founding partner at Apex Communications Network. We are a marketing strategy and business development consulting group, and we really passionately work with people that have purpose-driven organizations, people that really feel like engaging with community, forming relationships, and not just growing their company's revenue, but growing their company's impact is really the types of individuals that we enjoy working with. And I'm super, super excited for today. Because James and RJ really, really work hard at learning as much as possible about digital accessibility, what it means, and how to make it a little bit less scary, because a lot of it can be a little bit off-putting if you've never interacted with it before, especially if you're a business that has maybe been approached by somebody that says, hey, you're inaccessible. So hopefully today you'll get a little bit more insight to that. James, RJ, thank you for all of the work that you've put into this. I'm super, super proud of both of you, and I'm really excited to see what happens today. So I will get out of the way here and shut off my camera and pass it over to RJ.
Hello, everybody. I'm sorry for the lack of a camera today. I could not find mine to save my life after the last time I moved, but that was my big shiny bald head on the first slide. To get things started, I just wanted to thank everybody that's joining us on the live stream today. Obviously, unforeseen circumstances had forced us to nix the lunch portion of our lunch and learn, which was very heartbreaking to me and James. But being able to pivot this into a digital experience for everybody, and all the feedback that we got that it was all right and they'd still be joining us, has been awesome. Big thing and off the bat that I kind of want to thank are the sponsors and the people that helped us put this entire event together. First and foremost, Lori Moline and Mentor Stark. Lori sat down with me and James a few months ago now, was able to work through all of the nitty gritty details and put in a lot of work in the background to help us get us to today. We can't thank you enough, Lori, and we really appreciate it. Our other sponsors, as you can see below Mentor Stark, are Max Munchies and More, Pinnacle Press, and Cherry Blend Coffee Roasters. Max and Cherry Blend were going to be at the physical event today. Cherry Blend was going to bring their coffee and provide that for everyone, and Max was going to provide lunch. They worked with us for several weeks now trying to prep and get ready for this, and it was kind of last minute that we had to tell them we were moving everything over to digital, and they were super appreciative that we even offered them the chance to come in here and work with us, and we felt it was more than appropriate to still give them a shout out today, because if this had been in person, they would have been there feeding you guys and giving you some of the best coffee in North Canton. Pinnacle Press helped us put together the brochures for this and all the printable material and some of the graphics and stuff that you'll see today. Everybody at Pinnacle Press, thank you very much. We really appreciate the flyers. They were awesome. As our first event, I'm probably going to take it and frame it. So thank you to all of our sponsors. We very, very, very much appreciate it.
Absolutely. I just want to second that. And before we jump in, I want to just tell a quick story on like the power of networking and sort of how I, and as well as RJ, got to where we are today in the digital accessibility landscape. And it all starts with Lori. I met Lori when I was a junior at Walsh University, and she was delivering a networking workshop. I connected with her outside of that. And then over the course of the last couple of years, she has helped me sort of navigate professional development and has even helped my two younger brothers. And in working with one of my younger brothers, was able to connect with some organizations and some people out west who actually posed the initial question on how we were making digital experiences accessible for everyone. So if it hadn't been for meeting Lori and her making connections and introductions and all of the incredible things that Lori does, I probably wouldn't be sitting in the seat that I am today. I would still be running primarily SEO and digital ads and helping just build websites that were not accessible. So huge thank you to Lori and everything that you've done over the last couple of years. All right. So jumping in, we're going to just do some general, like clearing the air and setting some definitions and things like that. And then we'll jump into some quick fixes or quick action steps that can make your website, social media, online assets more accessible. And then we'll jump back in and talk about some of the risks and added benefits that come with being more accessible and more inclusive. So starting here with what is digital accessibility?
Yeah, obviously we should probably start off with what digital accessibility is, like James said, just to get a baseline of what we're talking about for the rest of the presentation today, for those that may not be unaware. Digital accessibility means that any website, document, application, or other channel that contains content is accessible by everyone, including people with disabilities. Whether it's a website, mobile app, PowerPoint presentation, or a social media platform, Facebook, TikTok, Instagram, Twitter, whatever it may be, everyone should be able to access and engage regardless of their abilities.
Perfect. So moving into why is digital accessibility important? So digital accessibility is important one, because it allows the opportunity to choose and have multiple options. I was in a conversation a few weeks ago, and if there were two options and one was not accessible, that opportunity to choose is taken away because then there's only one option. So outside of that, providing the opportunity to access, engage in whatever method or means that user prefers, it is what we're trying to accomplish. And when we don't do that, chances are someone like myself who lives with a visual disability, if I encounter an inaccessible experience, chances are that I'm just going to go somewhere else. I'm not going to say anything. I'm not going to raise flags or anything like that. But for a business, not hearing that feedback that an experience was not accessible can cause and lead to impact that the business itself is not aware of. So by thinking, building, and designing with accessibility in mind, we can reduce the chances that we are unintentionally excluding audiences or communities of people just because of the way our experience is designed. That being for someone who is blind using a screen reader, someone who is low vision using a magnifier, any combination of what's called assistive technology. We'll get into that later, but unintentionally excluding them can lead to impact, and we're trying to reduce that by allowing everybody the opportunity to access and engage in whatever way they like, whether that's just learning more information, purchasing, booking a call or a vacation, whatever that looks like. We're at least giving are designing it so that everybody has that opportunity and providing that equivalent experience.
So these three numbers here on screen, 5, 61, and 8, they probably mean nothing to most of the people in chat, but if anybody would like to take a stab at what these possibly mean or equate to within digital accessibility, I'll give you guys a few seconds here to type your answers if you want. If anybody in chat actually gets it, my head will explode. Jan, if you're still there, you can read answers if anybody guesses it.
I am not even sure what the numbers are.
Yeah, what do you think it is, Jan?
I have no idea. I'm looking forward to seeing what the answer is.
It's coordinates.
Right. The treasure map. The only thing, Jeff just said LOL. That's all we got. So.
All right. Well, so these three numbers should resonate and be pretty significant. The first one over there on the left is 5. Typically, that is going to be $5,000 is the starting cost to settle a lawsuit around digital accessibility. That's not including any of the added fees or costs that come with going through some process like that.
So we did get one guess. So Lori, Mentor Stark, guessed, is one of these numbers the number of disability classifications?
Close. 8 is very close to the disability categories.
It's not the 8 that you think it is. We'll tell you that.
$5,000 starting cost when a digital accessibility lawsuit is in place. 61. Approximately, there are 61 million adults living in the U.S. with a disability. Now, that might be a bigger number than most people would assume or think, but it shakes out to roughly 1 in 4 adults. And then lastly here is 8, which is $8 trillion in total global purchasing power from people with disabilities and the networks of friends and family that they influence.
Like I said, not the 8 that I think anybody expected.
So 5,000 starting costs, 61 million people living with a disability as adults in the U.S., and 8 trillion total global purchasing power. So moving along, let's jump in and talk about the categories of disabilities.
So as Lori said, she guessed that I think 8 was close. It was very close. It's 9 categories. Those disabilities include visual disabilities, auditory disabilities, deaf blindness, speech disabilities, seizure disabilities, mobile flexibility and body structure, cognitive disabilities, physiological and psychiatric disabilities, and multiple / compound disabilities.
And I just want to add a quick note here that most disabilities do present themselves on a spectrum. Not all disabilities are visual or visible just by looking at a person. And I hear this all the time that nobody would ever know that I had a visual impairment if I never told them. So prime example of an invisible disability. And when I tell people that I have a visual disability, a lot of them are a little bit confused on what that exactly means, on what I can and what I cannot see. And while a lot of disabilities come on that spectrum, I am low vision, so I'm somewhere in the middle, leaning more towards being totally blind. And just for reference, total blindness does not mean seeing complete darkness. A lot of people who are blind can still perceive between light and dark. And funny enough, a lot of people that are in the visual disability category actually do not know how to read and write in Braille, which is a common misconception that I hear all the time. I myself do know Braille, but that's not a super common thing like most people would generally assume. And then lastly, not all disabilities are permanent. If we are in an accident or there's medical recovery, there are temporary disabilities, which, like they imply, temporarily impact the user's ability to complete certain tasks or activities. So just a quick background there on that, and jumping into some statistics now on disabilities, because that 61 million, 1 in 4 might have caught some people off guard. So we just want to take some time to dive into that a little bit deeper.
Yeah, as James said, that roughly equates to 1 in 4. To break that down even further, you're looking at about 13.7 with a mobility disability, 6.8 with some form of cognitive disability, about 6% with visual disabilities, 4.5% with auditory disabilities, and people living 65 years or older, 40% of those adults also live with some type of disability. Those statistics play into the disabilities also impact other areas of a life, including obesity, diabetes, heart disease, smoking, and being the target of crime.
Absolutely. And what's funny is a lot of people that are in sort of that 65 plus range, as they're having a little bit harder time hearing or moving around or seeing, they don't necessarily consider that to be a disability. But generally speaking, when we're talking about accessibility, we are talking about a pretty large population here. And whether people define as having a disability or not is a little bit of a different discussion. It's not always as black and white of I have a disability, I don't have a disability. It's things like user preference and identification and other things along those lines come into play. And we are going to send a copy of the slide deck to everybody who wants it. And there is a link here to a little bit more information on the statistics around disabilities in the US provided by the CDC.
Here we're going to get into some of the assistive technology. For those who are unaware, assistive technology is defined as it is here on the slide, products used by people with disabilities to complete tasks they could not otherwise complete. When paired with computers and mobile devices, they are often called adaptive technologies or adaptive softwares. Looking here to the right, there are some of these examples: screen readers, magnifiers, text-to-speech, speech-to-text, sip and puff devices, braille displays, push and pull switches, and high contrast mode. So the picture that you guys are seeing there on the right, I believe, is the braille display.
Yep, absolutely. That is the refreshable braille display. I have used that before, and I've used quite a few of these in this list of examples. Screen readers and magnifiers almost every single day. Text-to-speech and speech-to-text, I've used both of those before. And then high contrast mode is probably the biggest one. When I encounter a website that didn't really think about color combination and how that would be able to be seen, that's where I tend to have problems or face challenges. And something like high contrast mode or turning on dark mode have been lifesavers, allowing me to complete work, allowing me to complete leisure activities, whatever that looks like. So I've used quite a few of these, but not all of these are directly tied to visual disabilities. There is a lot of overlap in assistive technology and who they are used by. I've seen people with certain cognitive challenges or disabilities who like to use screen readers. Sip and puff devices and push-pull switches are more mobility focused or dexterity focused. And these are just a few examples. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of options out there for users to choose and pick from based on their personal preference and what exactly they are trying to do. And that might seem a little bit overwhelming in the grand scheme of things, but when we're talking about designing digital experiences that are inclusive and accessible, a lot of these are built off of generally the same functionality. Many of us are familiar with the mouse and keyboard combination or using the touch feature on a mobile device. A lot of them root from the keyboard functionality or some of those gestures on the mobile devices. And so when we're talking about testing and reviewing to validate or prove that our online experiences are accessible, we don't have to test with 100,000 or even 100 different things. We can pick a handful of them and cover a lot of ground in doing so. So if we were to pick a handful of screen readers, checking with a magnifier and contrast mode and the keyboard functionality, we would actually be covering a huge amount of those assistive devices that are available. So I want to take a minute now to show some examples of assistive technology in use, as well as some accessible design features like captions, audio descriptions, and transcripts. Before we jump into the screen reader and the sip and puff devices, just a quick question for everybody who's watching. How many of us use captions when we're watching Netflix or Hulu or live TV or streaming on our phones or mobile devices? Just curious to see how many are actively using captions.
I do. I never used to, but Jenny and her mom both strictly watch any show, doesn't matter what it is, with captions on. And ever since then, I can't really go back.
I second that. I was editing podcasts yesterday, which, shameless plug, we're dropping another episode on Saturday about neuropsychology. When I'm editing pods, I have to focus on the audio, so I always use captions, just having something playing in the background. It looks like Jeff from Pinnacle Press also uses them, and Lori Menner Stark also said definitely, especially for The Crown, which I'm assuming is a TV show.
Yeah, on Netflix. Good show. I will personally say that I think I've read through, because of my girlfriend, I've read through the dialogue of Gilmore Girls at least three times.
And then Tracy Don Brewer says, our 30-year-old kids do, but we do not.
Cool. And captions have sort of gained a lot of momentum in the recent years. Whether you're in a loud environment and are watching something, you turn the captions on. There's tons of applications there. So there is a little bit of overlap between accessibility and usability. And some of the features that we're going to talk about enhance overall usability and user experience. They're not only beneficial to people with disabilities or people using assistive technology. So I just wanted to throw that note out there before we jump in and look at some of these. So I'm going to start with the captions, go to audio descriptions and text transcripts, and then we'll circle back. And I'm actually going to turn on NVDA, which is this purple logo in the middle over here, and go through a blog post that I wrote recently to show how it picks up and communicates through audio what's on the screen visually. And then we'll watch a video on how something like a sip and puff device works with a computer. So first up, I'm going to get the captions up. This is a trailer for a pretty popular Netflix show that's out right now called Wednesday. I think the captions on it are pretty well. And there is an art form to providing good captions or audio descriptions. So,
oh yeah.
Tell me if you pick up on some of the things outside of what they're saying that help paint the picture of what's happening through audio, through text in the captions. So I'm going to just pause it there for the sake of time. But the captions were timed up really closely to what was being said, and they were using punctuation and things like that to add emphasis or show the tonality of what was being said. So there's a lot that goes into captions, and it's not just what people are saying. Things like the music and off-screen sounds need to be included to ensure that equivalent experience. So. Next, I'm going to go over and jump to audio descriptions, which is a little bit more uncommon or lesser known, but definitely something that I've had conversations with people. And once they watch something with audio descriptions, they've said that there's so much more context to that happens visually on the screen that they didn't pick up on, that the audio descriptions actually helped them to pick up on. So this is the sort of intro scene from The Lion King. And I always use this example when showing how audio descriptions can be used to help illustrate the visual presentation through audio. So I'm just going to play this for a minute as well, sort of get a feel for what that experience is like with audio descriptions on a movie as iconic as The Lion King.
Hey, James, I can't hear anything.
What's that?
I'm unable to hear anything.
You can't hear that?
Mm-mm. Hmm. Chat, can you guys hear that? This one?
Could you hear the previous one?
No, but I think I thought that you had it muted.
I did not.
Menor Stark says that they're unable to hear either.
Uh-oh.
Okay. Well, we can just, when we send the slide deck, it is linked in the slides, or if you just want to look it up, a lot of newer shows are coming out with audio description versions. So highly encourage you to turn on audio descriptions for an episode and see what that's like.
I will hop in with one comment from the comment section here from Aaron Byrne, I want to say. Apologies if I didn't pronounce that right. But said, I watch shows with the audio description on whenever it's available, specifically because you pick up on so many things that are nonverbal that normally you would miss.
I would. Okay. So that's what I was going to explain is from the Lion King clip, what it, the audio description for anybody who's never dealt with it before would have basically explained in detail exactly what was going on with the toucan flying in and the animals rushing to the mountain and everything like that. I forget. I think, James, were we talking with, I believe it was Mike Hess at one point. We were talking about audio descriptions when I was being introduced to it. And he said, I think he told us that one of the craziest things you can do is do audio descriptions while watching a horror movie. And I tried it one time, and some of the creepy stuff that they hide in the background of scary movies that you never pick up on until it's blatantly told to you that something's creeping around in the background is terrifying.
Audio descriptions are something that surprises a lot of people because of how well done they have to be and how well done they are most of the time in capturing the theme, the environment, the body language. All of the nonverbal components to the visual presentation have to be provided through that description. And it is definitely a challenge to do, as well as fit it in between the dialogue of the audio. So definitely something there. I don't know if the screen reader or the Sip and Puff video are going to come with audio. So I don't necessarily know how to approach that.
So then have it play out on your computer, James, and get your mic close to it.
My mic is next to my speakers.
Then so. It should. Then hopefully it should be able to pick it up.
We'll try the screen reader, see if it picks it up. But if not, and you're genuinely interested in seeing how a screen reader works, my email is at the end. We can schedule a one-on-one and actually go through a couple of different websites together to see how a screen reader takes all of the content of a website, the headings, the pictures, the forms, everything, and presents that through audio. So I'm going to give it a shot, but I don't know if it's going to work. So I am going to just pop over to this post that I recently wrote, and just for how I'm navigating with the keyboard, I'm using the tab key and the arrow keys to move between one element and the next. So on the top right corner, currently it has a box around the contact link. So that's showing me where my keyboard focus would be at. So tell me if you can hear.
James L. Morgan document, banner landmark, navigation landmark, banner accessing.
Can we hear that? Or
yeah, I can hear it on my end.
Is it? I wonder if it's coming through YouTube. Can someone confirm? For me,
Menerstart gave us the thumbs
up. It is working. Okay, perfect. So I'm going to start up here in the navigation and just move through the elements until we get down into like the bulk of the paragraph, and just listen to how it's announcing the different elements on the page.
Toolbox zoom 80% button, share this page button, bookmark this tab button, James L. Morgan document link contact, skip to content link, James Morgan graphic visited link, navigation landmark about link, services link, blog visited link, current page, contact link, main landmark James Morgan link, October 10th bullet, heading level 1, accessing the digital world with a visual disability, written by link James Morgan, graphic James Morgan professional headshot, heading level 2, what is a visual disability, blindness is a spectrum and can affect people in a variety of ways, a visual disability cannot be corrected with contacts, glasses, or surgery. For me, my visual disability is caused by genetics.
So that's just a quick sort of demonstration on how it was interpreting
accessing the digital world.
The different elements on the page with the logo up in the top left corner saying that it could be clicked on as a link to navigate to the home page. Then it went through the navigation links for about, services, blog, and contact. It told me that it was published on October 10th. It was written by James Warnken, which could be clicked on to see other articles that were written by me. The heading level one, it said heading level one, accessing the digital world with a visual disability. Heading level two, what is a visual disability? It read the alternative text that has been placed on the image of my headshot there on the left. And what's super cool about the way a screen reader works is I can navigate with the tab keys or the arrow keys to move between one element and the next, but I can also use keyboard shortcuts, which we'll dive into a little bit later on how those work. But generally speaking, if I press the H key on my keyboard,
technology impacting the blind user experience heading level two,
it jumps me right to the next heading of the blog post without me having to listen to the whole paragraph. So similar to how we scroll through and scan a page to get an understanding of how that page works, using something like the H key, I can just listen to the headings of the page and pick which paragraphs I would like to continue reading through, or I could skip them and go right to
assistive technology,
the next heading.
Specific users heading level two.
And this is the same if I wanted to navigate by links, buttons, forms, pictures, headings, any type of element like that that's present on the page. More than likely, there's going to be a way to only navigate the page by those specific elements. So later when we talk about structure and layout, this is what we're talking about, is allowing users who can't necessarily see the visual presentation to still skim through the page and understand what it's about without necessarily going through every single word or picture or heading that's on the page. And like I said, when I didn't know if this was going to work, if you want to see how your website or a page within your website sounds with the screen reader, a lot of devices now do come with a screen reader installed on them. So if you're a Mac user, you have VoiceOver in your system preferences. If you're a Windows user, you have Narrator. If you want to check on your iPhone, VoiceOver comes on every single iPhone. If you're more of an Android user, TalkBack comes on every single Android device. But if you want to see how somebody with a little bit more experience and comfortability using a screen reader to navigate, feel free to reach out afterwards and we can go through it together and see how different elements are interpreted and presented through audio with the screen reader.
Number one.
Cool. So yeah, I just think it was the YouTube videos that wasn't picking up. So when we send the slide deck, all of these are linked if you want to check out the audio descriptions or the captions or the Sip and Puff device. But unfortunately, they were not working. So last thing here is text transcript. A lot of us have podcasts nowadays. When we're talking about designing accessible content and multimedia, podcasts are traditionally audio only, which could be a challenge or exclude people that have difficulty hearing. One of the ways that we can provide that equivalent experience with something like a podcast that is traditionally audio only is through the means of a text transcript. So this is just a very solid and well put together example in terms of the execution and providing multiple alternative formats. So the primary format here is the audio of a podcast, but as we scroll down, we get some information about the guests on the podcast, and then we get actually a full text transcript with a table of contents. And every time the speaker changes, it announces and tells you through text who is saying what. And then off to the right, we have the video version as well. So we're getting three different options on how we can perceive and interact and engage with this content, whether it's through audio only, video and audio, or through text-based. perfect example here of how this works. And when we talk about the added benefits later, I'm going to circle back to benefits of text transcripts when it comes to search engine optimization and some of that exposure component as well. So I'm looking forward to those added benefits, as many of us probably are. So shifting now, how do we actually get started? What are some easy wins and action steps that we can take today moving forward to build and design more accessible and inclusive experiences? So we just have four for you today, but they should be pretty easy. You shouldn't need to get into the code of your website to fix a lot of these or make adjustments to them. So I'll jump right in and start talking about them after we talk about the WCAG guidelines. So what are the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines? They are a set of guidelines underneath a set of principles that help us in producing accessible web content. So here we have four high-level principles that sort of categorize and group everything for us, and they are perceivable, operable, understandable, and robust. And that essentially is, can the content be perceived by multiple, by a wider range in multiple formats? Is the content able to be operated with different devices and inputs? Can the user understand the purpose of the content? And then lastly, robust being, does the content work on current and future versions of technologies like operating systems and browsers and mobile devices? The last one here, robust, is not as critical, I would say, but it's definitely something to keep in mind because we do live in a world where we get a new iPhone every year. We get updates to softwares and hardwares all the time. We need to make sure that we're staying on top of that. But sort of diving one step deeper into the guidelines and the success criteria, it really boils down to three different levels of conformance to what are the WCAG version 2.1 guidelines. And that it being single A, which is sort of your baseline, double A, which is what a lot of governments and legislation follows around the world, not just here in the US. Double A is pretty standard practice, but you have to conform with single A before you can move up to double A. And then the highest and the most strict, if we're working with government contracting and procurement and things like that, would be triple A. And a lot of the triple A is just an extension of the double A. Prime example with captions. Double A says that we need to have captions on all pre-recorded audio. Triple A just says that we need to have captions on all live audio. So there's just, it's a variation or one step higher, if you will, in terms of the difference between A, double A, and triple A. A lot of them tend to build on top of one another, ultimately to create that accessible experience for everyone.
Alrighty. James said a little bit ago, getting into some easy wins that we can do to make things more digitally accessible. The first one that I want to go over, because it pertains to me as someone who's colorblind, is color contrast. So by the WCAG guidelines that James was just talking about, a contrast ratio of 4.5:1 for small text. So that's any text on a website or a platform or a blog that's 18 point and below needs to follow that. A 3:1 ratio for large text. So that's any text, maybe headers or anything that are above 18 point normal and above. And anything for buttons, controls, toggles, interactive links, links to other parts of the website, all need to have a contrast ratio of 3:1. So as me and James are going through websites and looking at their digital accessibility, one of the tools that we really like to use is the link that you see down there underneath the color wheel, which is the WebAIM contrast checker. James is going to walk us through that. It's actually very neat what it can do for you.
Perfect. So when we're adding those interactive elements or text to a website, this is a phenomenal tool to just do a quick check and say, okay, that color contrast it meets the minimum threshold of 4.5 to 1 or 3 to 1 or whatever it is based on the type of element. What I like the most about this tool is this could look a little bit intimidating with these sort of hex codes with the hashtag and then all of the numbers and letters to follow. But you can actually click into here and have a full color palette. And they do have an eyedropper tool here that if I wanted to go to a different web page, I can just click that eyedropper and grab the color of that section. So here it put this sort of peachy color in as my foreground color, which would be that button, that text, and then the background color being white over here. But it shows me the exact contrast ratio, which is in this case 2.09 to 1. And as RJ just mentioned, we want 3 to 1 or 4.5 to 1. So what I like the most about this tool is instead of just showing you a ratio and you sort of having to figure out which it works with and which it doesn't, it will actually tell you right underneath. So in terms of this peach on a white background and it being 2.09 to 1, we would actually not meet the success criteria for AA or AAA for small text nor large text or user interface components. But if we were to come back up here and drag this down just a little bit, we can see it jumps up to 3.95 to 1. So now we're still failing for small text and AAA on large text, but we're passing for AA. So theoretically, we could use this for our headings or any text that is above 18 point or our user interface components like the check mark or the form field outline we see here on the right. Generally speaking, this tool is a go-to for us and just makes it super easy to do a quick check and say, that color scheme works, that color palette works. Those two colors we would recommend avoiding when you're using them in combination. So we can see black on white, 21 to 1 passes across the board.
And people love to go crazy with color. So this one we default to quite a bit just to make sure and run everything through it.
Yep. And it is just called, if you Google search WebAIM contrast checker, it should be one of the first links.
It'll pop right up.
Pretty cool tool to use.
The second quick win that I want to go over with everybody, and James kind of talked about this when he was going through his blog post, are the heading levels. So as you guys can see from the graphic there on the right, heading level one is the general topic of the entire page or a section of the page. Underneath that, then you break into heading level two, and underneath the heading level twos, you have threes, yada, 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 until you eventually can get all the way to having heading level six broken down under each one of those. This organization comes very heavy into play when someone is going through your digital content website blog using a keyboard like James did. One example off the top of our head when we've looked at stuff, to give you guys kind of an idea of what could happen if the heading levels are incorrect on your page. We were skimming through a website, and either they didn't have any heading levels or they had mislabeled them wrong when someone was using, like James did, the H key to go through heading by heading. It started jumping and missing significant portions of their entire homepage. So as someone, if they were completely blind, only using a keyboard to scale through that website in a screen reader, it would have been as if that entire section of their homepage was non-existent. There was no way to back up into it. There was no way to circumnavigate through it to the screen reader, to the path for the keyboard through the homepage. It's as if it was never there. And I think for very obvious reasons, that can be critically bad.
And just to give a quick example of how a heading structure might look using the heading 1, 2, 3, 4, the example I always get is like, pick a very high level topic like sports. If we're talking about something like the NBA, our heading level 1 would be sports teams within the NBA. Our heading 2s then would be those individual teams, the Cleveland Cavaliers, the Los Angeles Lakers, those would be our heading level twos. And then if we were to talk about a specific topic within that team, for example, the Lakers and LeBron, LeBron James would be our heading level three. So it just shows sort of a hierarchy of structure of NBA is our big topic that we're talking about. The Cavaliers or the Lakers are subtopics. And then within those, we have players or news updates or whatever that correspond with those teams. So it allows the user to know that they're getting into smaller, more detailed sections of content. Instead of thinking that that entire page is about LeBron James, they know that the content about him is just a smaller section of the grand scheme of the page as a whole.
The third win that I want to go over today is multimedia. When it comes to multimedia, as I think most people know, they're broken into two portions. You have audio and video, podcasts and YouTube. This can all be live or pre-recorded, as James said before, and some of those WCAG guidelines are dependent on whether or not the content is live or if it is pre-recorded. So your audio is all-encompassing from captions, transcripts, and even sign language interpretations, video transcripts, and audio descriptions for all your video multimedia.
And I will add that if you are producing video, there are tools out there now that are available and fairly inexpensive that can generate closed captions for you, that can generate a transcript in 5 minutes or less for just a few dollars. So it's not something that we need to go out and necessarily hire an expert to do, unless it's an hour long video or a 45-minute podcast. We can generally use some of those tools and be pretty confident that they are accurate up to about 90%, if not a little bit more. The only one that's hard to generate would be those audio descriptions, which in that case, we would want to hire somebody that has experience doing that type of work. Cool. And then the last sort of quick win here, this is just labeling and describing as much as humanly possible. So when we're adding links or buttons, toggles, forms, images, any type of element outside of text to a website that is interactive or adds meaning or value to the content around it, we just want to make sure that we're labeling and describing everything properly and completely. Links being a big one. So avoid falling into the click here or learn more or some of that vague language when you're linking to another page within your website or somebody else's website. The best sort of advice I can give is to actually go to that page and look at what it says across the top in the tab, or look at the heading level one and use that as your link text. When we're adding things like buttons and controls and toggles, we want to provide visually, but also semantically in the background, whether or not something has been turned on or off, whether it's been expanded or collapsed, whether it's been checked or unchecked. There's so many options there, but just making sure that it's provided both visually on the screen and in the background, so that when somebody comes through with a screen reader like I did earlier, it will tell me checkbox not checked, or it will say unvisited link page title. Making sure that we're labeling things like that, as well as form fields and all of that. And then sort of shifting a little bit into images. A lot of us have probably added images to our Instagram page or our website and seen the option to add alt text. And from my original background, alt text was a place to fill in text to get that image to show up in the search results. The alt text is actually what was read when I navigated to the image with the screen reader where it said James Warnken professional headshot. That was the alt text. So instead of seeing that image, I heard through audio a description of that image by filling in that alt text tag. And I've done a series of posts on my LinkedIn on how to apply alt text on different platforms like WordPress, Wix, Squarespace, Shopify. There's other platforms out there, but generally it's going to work the same. Just try to keep in mind that we're describing it in relation to the content around it, not necessarily literally in what the composition of that image is, unless that's the purpose. So just a funny example here on a product that doesn't necessarily label or clearly label everything, and it, that being a remote to a TV. I remember as a kid getting the TV remote, and it felt like there was 100 buttons on there. The only ones that I ever knew how to work were the power buttons, the input options, change the channel, and turn the volume up and down. And the principles of universal design say that we should try to reduce risk, confusion, and potential for errors. Whereas if you click the wrong button on a remote, something might happen, something might not happen. There's really no way to know, and that's because of sort of ambiguous or missing labels within that set of controls.
Does anyone know what the colored buttons on the remote do? Because I don't.
I don't know. I couldn't tell you. We'll see if anybody does know.
Yeah, I also have no idea. So unless somebody in the chat knows.
I also don't know what EPG is. And I haven't listened to the radio in a decade.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Cool. So we'll keep moving. Sort of transitioning into the sort of last section we have today before we open things up for Q&A, which is team commitment and creative thinking can get you a very long way. A lot of us like to work in teams. We like to collaborate, whether it's digitally, in person, communicating and talking about accessible design and different options and opportunities can definitely push things a long way. And we'll touch on that when we get to those added benefits. But first, is the risk really worth it?
Some of the stuff that I kind of just want to go over here to end our presentation is we talked earlier in the beginning of the presentation about the fines and possibilities of, you know, going through a lawsuit or anything like that. We hope that by learning a lot of this stuff, you can avoid some of the frivolous stuff that can happen with not being digitally accessible. Outside of that, though, I don't think anyone is purposely designing anything that they do or put out there to be explicitly inaccessible to people on purpose, and to keep things mostly digitally accessible keeps you in the clear, because if not, as you can see here on this slide, not only could you be hit with a fine, but it damages the company's reputation and the public perception of it if you're not willing to work with such a large consumer base. And unfortunately, I think most people will agree with me, but people like to talk about the bad, and then if something good happens, they rarely talk about it. I don't know if that has something to do with just the human condition and human nature, but I hear a lot of people, when something goes right, the hype sometimes isn't as grand as when things go wrong, and I feel negative press spreads far faster than good press.
Absolutely. And then, so on the sort of contrast there, what are some of the benefits that come with being digitally accessible and inclusive? We talked a little bit about providing alternative formats to allow more audience to choose how they want to access and engage. But on top of that, we see things like better organic performance. So a lot of us over the last couple of years have really put attention into our online presence, search engine optimization being one of them. the more we describe and give meaning and value to the contents within our page, the more we're going to see return from those algorithms that we try so hard to meet and stay in the loop and ahead of the trends on. With that, we're also going to see more accurate analytics. I don't know how many of us watch our Google Analytics or our Facebook metrics or whatever that looks like, but chances are if somebody stumbles across your website and it's not accessible from the very beginning, they're going to leave in your analytics. It's going to show that somebody was on your website for about 4 seconds before they left. And there's no context to that. But if we are more accessible, we're going to have longer session durations. We're going to have more interactions and engagements because we're not immediately preventing someone from continuing and turning them away. Increased word of mouth. RJ just mentioned negative press spreads faster. But similar, if I have an incredible experience of something surprised me, it was way better than I could have ever imagined. I have a brother who's also visually impaired. I'm going to call him and tell him about it. So I believe it's a little bit more likely for positive word of mouth when something is accessible and the experience has been designed purposely to include and work with different assistive technologies and user preferences. I do believe there's benefit there, as well as faster innovation and advancement. Everybody's trying to continuously improve and make things better. When we incorporate people with disabilities or we have conversations with real users and get feedback, that process becomes significantly shorter and faster and less costly when we know exactly what needs done. So instead of having to use automated tools or anything like that, the best way to get that information on what exactly needs done is to connect with real users and get that conversation going so that you can and move forward in a collaborative effort. As I just mentioned a few slides ago, team collaboration, team commitment, creative thinking can go a long way. And then sort of wrapping up here, better customer relationships and better usability for everyone. So when we were talking about captions, a lot of us use captions. That is sort of an example of the usability for everyone coming into play and providing a better experience to build better relationships, because we're not limiting the options and the opportunities to a certain group of people or and excluding a group of people for that matter. So a lot of good things do come when we are digitally accessible. Now, I will say there are some stigmas and some controversy and things within this space, but generally speaking, starting and making incremental improvements and progress over a period of time is absolutely better than trying to forget about it and ignore it and hope that somebody doesn't come back with feedback of, I couldn't complete the contact us form because it's not accessible with X, Y, or Z technology. So that is all we had for today in terms of like getting the conversation started, some quick wins and action items. I want to open things up now in our last 20-ish minutes or so. If there are any questions about specific things or you just want to hear a little bit more about something that we've already covered, now would be the time to ask those questions. And if you don't want to ask a question in the chat, mine and RJ's emails are here on the slides that we'll send out after. If you want to reach out to us personally and schedule a one-on-one conversation or just ask questions via email, I always encourage, if you're not sure, just ask. I have a ton of people that send me their web pages, or they make a change to something and they just want to make sure that it works or that it's tagged properly. It's anything like that, feel free to reach out to me or RJ and we'll take a look at it and give you some quick feedback.
Absolutely.
We do have a couple of questions already queued up. So I made sure that I asked a little while ago for people to just post them in the chat, and then I would bring them up at this time. So we've got two, one from the Canton Symphony Orchestra and one from Aaron. So the first one from the Canton Symphony Orchestra is currently at the Canton Symphony. We have a hearing loop in our auditorium for those with assisted listening devices. Is there anything else that we could do to assist our hearing impaired constituents with their experience?
In terms of like an in-person experience, there's a lot going on. I've had conversations about some of the things that they're experimenting with on like Broadway with live shows like that. The headset device, I forget the exact name of it. RJ, I don't know if you remember. But there's devices like that that for people with difficulty hearing absolutely work. Some of them are better options than others in terms of like changing the volume levels and things like that. But outside of that, off the top of my head, I am not entirely sure.
Interesting to dig into.
Yeah, let me look into it and I will follow up with an email or get in touch with you guys in some way or another to sort of explore that, because that's an interesting question that we haven't really tapped into, like audio experience in-person events.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's a really cool question. Thank you for shooting that into the chat. The next one comes from Aaron, and it's a huge problem I run into occasionally is the image CAPTCHA. When there is no audio alternative for this, those CAPTCHAs prevent me from getting tasks done on the website.
CAPTCHA is... Some forms of CAPTCHA, I would say, are better than others, like the ones that do include the audio alternative. Generally speaking, when I do CAPTCHA on a website, it is a simple addition math problem, like 2 plus 3. The crawl robots or the spam robots, for whatever reason, can't do math. So I turn to 2 plus 3 as like the validation mechanism. But I have seen signing up for platforms, and the form of reCAPTCHA is select the picture of the blue duck. Yep. And for someone with low vision that already has a hard time seeing those pictures anyway, now they're relying on me to, one, see the color of the duck, but two, to use a mouse to click on it because it's not accessible with the keyboard. So in a lot of those sort of custom widgets like CAPTCHA or embedded frames, or if we have like a live social preview, widgets like that typically are going to be less accessible by default. However, there are things that we can add to that to make it more accessible. We can add a title and descriptive text, and we can also make use of a language called Aria that allows us to make certain elements and components with that more accessible by labeling and describing, like we just talked about a few slides ago. But definitely in terms of CAPTCHA with no audio option as an alternative, I would recommend everyone avoid that. It's frustrating across the board, in my opinion, regardless of ability.
I love that. The next one comes in from Canton Symphony Orchestra again, and they are asking, is there a way to have our website tested for an accessibility rate?
So a rating is something that we typically try to avoid, because we don't want to get into the mindset or the headspace of we're doing this to try to necessarily reach a certain score or check off certain boxes. RJ and I test and review websites, and we don't actually score it. We just provide feedback on these are some areas of improvement. Here's potential solutions. So whenever we review a site, it's not just this doesn't work. It's this doesn't work, and here's how we recommend approaching fixing it. There's no real way to score that unless you're counting up all of the success criteria and then figuring out some percentage. Instead, we look at it as an ongoing sort of effort to incrementally improve the experience. So if it comes back with 10 things to work on, we'll say, okay, let's tackle 3 to 5 this month, 3 to 5 next month, and in a couple months, review them again, check them to make sure that what we have done is actually successfully working, and keep moving forward and finding areas to improve not just the accessibility, but the overall usability and user experience.
And James, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but when we high-level scan and go through and do these walkthroughs of people's websites and give you guys feedback, we're basing kind of everything that we pass or fail on the AA compliancy of the WCAG that we talked about previously.
Yeah, and just to sort of add on to that, we do rank them on severity. So if this is something that is going to completely exclude an entire audience from interaction at entirely, that's going to be higher priority, more severe of an issue than
something we'll tackle first.
Yep. Yeah, something like the alt text isn't completely accurate in relation to the content around it. That's going to be more low-hanging fruit, that's a little bit less of a priority than a form that somebody with a screen reader completely cannot fill out.
If you wanted us to go above and beyond and said check all of our stuff for AAA compliancy, we could do that as well.
Awesome. And then Tracy Dawn Brewer jumped in and she asked, don't some browsers approach CAPTCHA differently? Do you recommend using one browser over another?
That's an interesting question. I personally use the native browser to the device in most cases. So when I'm on my iPhone or my iPad, I'm using Safari. And when I'm on my Windows, I'm either using Edge or Chrome. Chrome has sort of exploded in popularity. But in terms of creating the accessible experience, one of the things that we want to be mindful of are user preferences. And there might be some users that are using a MacBook and have Chrome installed. So it's more about what's more widely accessible, which is why when we do testing, we test with multiple screen readers on multiple browsers within multiple devices, to make sure that we're not only excluding an even like smaller subset of blind Mac OS users that are using voiceovers, because there are those inconsistencies across the different technologies. We just want to make sure that we're thinking about the most popular and the most widely used combinations and testing for those. So it's hard to say one browser is better than the other. A lot of it's personal preference. I personally don't care what browser I'm using, as long as it works with a magnifier and my screen reader can interact with it.
And for those who may not know, VoiceOvers is the native and like pre-built in screen reading option, I believe, in all Mac devices.
All Apple devices.
Apple devices. Over.
Yep. It's in the accessibility settings. And it, and an iPhone, it's just a toggle. But if you turn it on, there is a little bit of a learning curve there. So I would recommend looking up some of the guides for the gestures or the keyboard commands before you jump in. And I will say, a lot of people think when they turn a screen reader on, they can no longer use their mouse. They have to use only the keyboard. You can still use a mouse when you have a screen reader turned on a laptop or a desktop device.
Love that. And that takes us all the way through our Q&A there.
We've got about 10, 15 minutes left. So if there's any topics you want us to sort of high level cover, any more questions, anything like that, feel free to throw them out there, and
we'll otherwise we'll have to listen to RJ do horrible stand-up. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh god. I didn't prep any of my material.
You mean you don't have any bits on standby?
Me, I'm a good storyteller, but nobody came here for that.
True.
And like I said, if you don't want to ask the questions, our emails are here, so feel free to reach out. We'll be happy to talk, check things, whatever that looks like. We are here to make an impact, so feel free to reach out at any point.
Once again, I want to thank everyone for being here today and jumping on this live stream with us. It would have been better to see everybody in person. Me and James are planning on making this a repeatable thing that we do several times a year. Once again,
it's
thanks.
It's not always going to be the same content, just as a heads up.
Yeah. Thanks again to all of our sponsors and everyone who's been participating. And we hope you guys took some stuff away from this, piqued your interest. if not, you know, maybe shine some lights on things that we all could be doing in developing digitally accessible content.
RJ, I think I may have opened a can of worms. We're not
going to No.
Canton Symphony Orchestra just commented and said that they would definitely love the stand-up routine. So the next live stream we do, we can start with a cheesy RJ joke.
And this will stay on the YouTube channel as a video after, correct?
Yes, it will. And we also are recording kind of like a version that we're going to cut down and edit a little bit. And James, you read everybody's minds. Comments are flooding in right now asking if it will be recorded. But we will probably upload it to a Google Drive. And so if any of y'all reach out to James or RJ by this weekend, we'll have the video available via link, and we can just shoot it to y'all. That way you can share it with anybody else that you think may benefit from having this knowledge. That's kind of our intention behind these, is to make sure that we're providing a lot of the value and then setting it up in a way that if you run into somebody that needs to know these types of things, you have an easy to share resource to give them and point them in the right direction. Cool.
Perfect. My final note would be accessibility is hopefully now we can all agree that it's not super technical. We don't always need to get into the code or the back end to make some of these improvements, and no one has all the answers. So question was posed about the audio experience in person. I don't have an answer to that right now. That is where that team collaboration and team effort comes into play, as well as the creative thinking, because now I'm going to go look that up and look into it and learn about it. Everybody has their area of expertise, just like any other industry. There's certain professionals that are experts in certain areas of accessibility, whether it's built environments, websites, applications, documents, testing and remediation. There's so many avenues to explore that no one has all the answers. So we do need to collaborate and think as a team in order to continue to bridge the gap between accessibility and technology.
Love that. I think with that, probably let everybody get along with their days.
Oh, yeah. Darn. I just thought of a good story too.
No, did you?
My Buick. That's probably the craziest, the best, funniest story I could ever tell. I can open with that one next time.
That sounds like a plan. So
2002 Buick LeSabre. Keep it in mind. It's almost the end of me.
Keep an eye out for the next event. RJ will open up with a story about his 2002 Buick LeSabre.
Death trap, more like it.
And just a quick rundown as we're signing off. Thank you to Canton Symphony Orchestra, Tracy Don Brewer, Mentor Stark, Aaron, We've got Jeff Kelly and Pinnacle Press and about 28 other people that were hiding and not in the comments. So for the 28 of you that showed up and were not commenting, I see you, I'm watching, and I want more interaction from you the next time we do this, because I love hearing from y'all. With that signing off, thank you for hanging out, and we will have this video out via the YouTube channel and email by this weekend.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you for being flexible and shifting with us. Have a great weekend.
And boom, Stroom's down.